Hi, I'm Olivia Linder.
Hi, I'm Raman Bhadia.
And we're here to talk about personalizations, AI-generated product descriptions, and recommendations. Now, let's pick questions for each other.
Do it.
Okay. Three words. Explain the impact of generative AI on Amazon.
Ooh, number one, amazing. Number two, exciting. Number three, fun. These are the three best words that we can use to describe the impact on Amazon.
Yeah. I'm like, oh my God. It's big. It is big. That's twice three. Oh, your turn.
It's my turn. All right, let's go. Okay. If you could create a generative AI model to help you with your daily tasks, what would the most unusual or quirky task you'd want it to assist you with be?
Tell me when I'm actually hungry versus bored hungry or procrastinating hungry, because I just eat all the time. And if something was to tell me, no, this is this kind of hunger, you should do this, like go back to writing your paper, I would use that. What about you? You have a new baby, so it could be...
Interpreting the baby's cries, different kind of cries and sounds would be an amazing thing to do. Yep.
I take it back. I want to talk to my cat. Done.
I thought that's what you'll go with.
I should have thought of that. Okay. Well, eating and cat talk.
Okay. My sounds
baby.
Awesome. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. What was your team's overall vision and strategy behind embracing generative AI technology?
Honestly, it was kind of a no-brainer for us because there were things that we all already wanted to do. But it was just that the cost of doing them was quite high before Gen AI. Gen AI kind of unlocked the doors that, you know, otherwise would have required a lot of people, months and months of efforts. And now it was possible to do all of that and much more in a much shorter time. And thanks to all the tools by AWS, like Bedrock, SageMaker, it became super easy to experiment things out and put things in front of our customers.
Yeah. And it's funny, when I think of our team picking up generative AI, before I moved to this team, I worked as a partner and you were one of the first teams I worked with who were embracing it.
Yeah.
This is amazing. Wow. And so now I'm really glad to be working on it.
Yeah.
It has opened up so much.
Yes, it indeed has.
Yeah. What were the factors that allowed your team to act quickly to create generative AI solutions?
Ooh, I think...
It's a great one.
It's because how easy it is. You have Bedrock, which is a great tool. And I was going to say SageMaker is super easy. It takes less than 5 minutes to set up your notebook instance and integrate it with Bedrock, try out different models. But the best part is if you're just starting out, you don't even need SageMaker. You can just try... Bedrock's chat and image playground, try different things there, see which model works best, and then iterate quickly on that using SageMaker and other services to finally productionalize what are you working on. So it's super simple, super fast, and very easy.
Yeah. The number of experiments our team has been able to do is incredible.
It's amazing. Yep.
My old team, we could barely get 5 experiments a year because it was so big and gosh, there were too many factors. And this is, you've done 20, something
yep,
like
yep,
that?
Yep, 20 it's plus incredible. Experiments in a few months. Yep, that's amazing.
Wow, yeah.
How does the solution work and what are the key benefits it provides?
I'm going to skip of how it works. And maybe you want to walk us through those three big steps. Actually, do you want to do that? And then I can talk about the benefits.
Sure.
Great.
So anything that we do, it basically, there are three different stages of it. So stage one is generation, where we actually create the content that is being presented to the customer. So if it's a personalized product titles, generation would be of a personalized product title. If it's a recommendation widget title, that'll be the generation of a recommendation widget title. Step two is the auditing. So auditing is also automated where we use Gen AI to audit whether the titles are proper, whether the if they're making any false promises, if there's anything else that is wrong with them. And step three is correction. So like if we find any failures, which, you know, everybody makes mistakes, there always are.
Not all of us, okay.
Some of us make mistakes. And so the correction phase is the one that actually takes in feedback from what got failed and then fixed that. So this is how the entire system works.
Yeah. And I will brag about the benefits. There's really two main ones that I think of in the two types of really core work that we do. One is the content that we generate is so much more engaging. We could have, instead of like inspired by your interests, my favorite is perfect food for your feline friend. And it's perfect because I have a cat. And the second one is showing more relevant information. The fact that, you know, if something I'm buying is in a 10 pack, that could be hidden out of the viewport. And so if we're bringing up that 10 pack, because I've been looking for bulk, is brought to the front, fantastic. Or if I'm looking for something that's not name brand, I'm looking for something potentially a little less expensive, that will show up in, will highlight that for customers. So really, customers are finding what they want quicker, and they're finding more engaging, interesting products to discover because we are engaging them more and not creating banner blindness.
Yep. Oof, this is interesting, Olivia. Perfect question for you. Can you share any quantitative or qualitative metrics that demonstrate the impact of generative AI on the company's business goals?
Sure. I will talk about our product. Our first experiment in search results, where we were tailoring titles to ensure the most relevant information was within the viewport of the customer's phone or desktop, was really, really impactful on the amount of time someone needed to search and the like amount of scrolling they needed to do to find a product they wanted to find. And as a customer-obsessed company, we are so attuned to how we are adding friction or taking away kind of customer shopping hurdles. And that one, making it easier for me to find what I'm actually looking for, was amazing. And to be honest, I wasn't sure how much of an impact we would have. It was huge. It was a really positive impact. And so if we can make it easier for customers to not have to return later on, or to be able to say, oh, this one is for me, it's not for little kids. Mm-hmm. Great. Even better.
Ooh, what measures or frameworks did your team put in place to ensure the responsible and ethical use of Gen AI?
Ooh, I will say the amount of quality assurance that we've put in to our products to make sure it's safe wording, it's acceptable wording, it's honest wording, and it's relevant and kind of engaging. You were able to put into an adversarial LLM, so it's checking itself. And it has been incredibly successful because we want to be honest. So I think it's super important. And I think we've done a really good job at making sure that we are keeping a safe space for customers when using Gen AI.
If I'm an aspiring developer interested in AI and ML, what advice would you have for me?
Go talk to Raman. That's what I would say. Don't talk to me, because I work on a great team of developers. What would you say?
I would say if you're trying to pick up anything, the best way is to just go and try it out. So get your hands dirty. You know, you have AWS has incredible tools, Bedrock, SageMaker, try out, you know, see what models work best for you, see what gives you the best results, and yeah, go from there. So just try out different things. That's the best answer.
And actually, I do have some advice. I feel like just try it. And that's kind of what you said, but the more I think about it, the more solutions there are. Like, I feel like the engineers on our team are always just like, let's try this
things out. Yep.
Oh.
Yep.
And it's incredible.
How has the adoption of generative AI impacted the team's process and production workflows at Amazon?
I gotta say, the applications we have now where we've made things self-service and where we're planning are really exciting. I want to talk about the future if you want to talk about the now. When I think of where this could go for manual content auditing and making sure things are automatically translated, are spelled correctly, there's quick, immediate synthesis of things. It is going to save hundreds of thousands of hours of work that can be spent on really interesting customer problems rather than spell checking. Mm-hmm. And our product is going to do that. And I am so pumped for that. And I think there are some that have even kind of unburdened our team this year.
Yeah. Yeah. So on the productivity side, I think I see a lot of devs in the team using Amazon Q to write code, to, you know, and then one thing that I am not as good at was like writing docs and all, and that's where generative AI has helped me a lot. Like, it helps me audit things and then edit my documents and then make sure everything is neat and polished. On the product side, yeah, of course, there's a lot of innovation that has happened in the company in the last year or so, which is, and your customers are really loving that. So that's amazing to see.
Is that why your papers get less feedback than mine? Now I know.
That's the cheat code.
As a solutions architect or developer, what stands out to you about AWS generative AI?
Oof. I'll say the biggest benefit is how Bedrock provides you with a list of different LLMs and models that you can use. And so for the applications that we have, we use different LLMs for different use cases. And it was very easy for us to pick and choose because Bedrock gave us a nice clean interface to interact with different kinds of models. And so just having that flexibility of, you know, having a singular interface and trying out different things, see what works best of you was amazing.
And not to brag for you more, but it also streamlined the work you were doing because it was so flexible, right?
Yep. All
love
good
that.
Things, yep.
Oh gosh, this could be a big one. Quick, walk us through your AWS generative AI infrastructure and how it plugs into your existing infrastructure.
Okay, so our systems are literally simpler. And so we only use 5 different services. So we use
just 5.
S3, just 5 AWS services, you know, your usual. We use S3 for all data exchange. We use ECR to deploy the containers, Docker containers of our code. We use AWS Batch to execute our jobs. And we use Bedrock, of course, to, you know, query interface with the different models that we're using. And then we use CloudWatch for all the metrics and monitoring purposes. And for development, we use SageMaker because prototyping is SageMaker is just meant for that. So it's incredibly easy to do it there. So those are the 5 + 1, 6 things that our architecture is based off.
Nice.
If you could give one piece of generative AI advice to another developer, what would it be?
Go big. Solve all my problems. Not that I'm a developer, but from what I've just been able to see over the last year or two, the amount of change that it can bring, keep going with it. I have never felt unsafe with any of the generative AI that we've seen, or I've never felt like it was taking away from an experience for me. And so I'd love to see where else I could benefit from it. Maybe that's selfish, but go big with it. See what you can do. And
that is the perfect answer. I was going to say the same exact thing. Just go big, dream big. Everything is possible.
Great minds think alike. Good. I had so much fun today. Thank you.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Can we do this every day?
Let's do it. It was awesome.